While it may be cold outside, things are getting toasty warm at Global Voice Broadcasting. Heat up your winter nights with the hottest topics, the hottest celebrities, and today's best music. It's why Global Voice Broadcasting is becoming your 24/7 home for the music and talk you want right now. Discover your favorite shows and music anytime at globalvoicebroadcasting.com.
I highly recommend Ms. Hicks. Her books, her CDs are encouraging.
I bought her book, A Hill to Climb. She's a very inspirational speaker.
And I look forward to one day being able to work with her.
Your power lies within you. Let it loose.
Aspiration, inspiration, motivation, edification, determination. These are the keys of life success brought to you by none other than award-winning author, motivational lecturer, business consultant, and much more as she gets you aimed to your purpose. And now, ladies and gentlemen, young and elder, from Hollywood to the entire world, here is your host of Aim to Purpose, the radio show, Louise Hicks, along with her co-host, yours truly, Kenan Wesley Mason.
Hello, world. How's everybody today? I hope you had a great weekend. I did. And guess what? This is the week leading up to Valentine's Day, where everybody's going to be out buying all this delicious things for their sweethearts. So I kind of tidied myself up for it a little bit. Had my little red bow on and everything. But we have a great show for you today. We are going to talk about five strategies for getting results.
And amazing results.
Amazing, yes, results. So I'm Louise Hicks, your host.
And I'm Kenan Wesley Mason, your co-host. And we want to thank all of you from around the world. So good afternoon, good morning, and good evening to all of you listening and watching. We welcome you. And before we get started, Shamika Brown with our entertainment news and community news. Take it away, Shamika.
How y'all doing? Happy Monday. And I have a bit of entertainment and community news for you. This is Monday, the 9th of February. We're already moving forward in the year. And shout out to everybody who's getting ready for Valentine's Day. So listen, we'll jump right into it with some box office numbers. The SpongeBob movie, 56 million. Can y'all believe it? Wow. Go ahead, Nickelodeon. Somebody still loves SpongeBob. Yes. I bet you it's you grown folks out there watching it, too. Mm-hmm.
They are, because my daughter is 25, and she has SpongeBob all over her dresser.
It's crazy. 56 million, so that's awesome. American Sniper, number two, 24.17 million. Still hanging in there in the top three. Mm-hmm. Rounding out the top three is Jupiter Ascending. So that's the new film that came out. A little sci-fi for you. Don't have any international numbers, but I will get back to you on that for next week. So so that's box office report. Upcoming releases. So I went ahead and picked my favorite for this weekend, 50 Shades of Grey, honey. Mm-hmm. Yes. So if you guys do not know, 50 Shades of Grey is going to be released in theaters on Valentine's Day, February 14th.
And that's based on the best-selling novel, is that correct?
Yes, by E.L. James. And so the background is, it's a literature student. Life changes when she gets caught up with a handsome yet tormented billionaire. Mm. He crazy, y'all.
Mm. Just from what y'all see. Tormented billionaire.
Tormented. Wow. Noted, right? cool thing is, they have a soundtrack out as well, but now available on iTunes, and Beyonce, Annie Lennox, The Weeknd, and more. I think I even saw something from Frank Sinatra. So this is a cute little soundtrack to go along with your movie date. So get that for your boo.
Yeah.
And check it out. Let us know what you think about that film. So it is award season, and last night, the 57th annual Grammy Awards went down at Staples Center. Yes. Music heavyweights, including Beyonce and Annie Lennox, were in the house last night. And highlights include performances by Rihanna, Kanye West, featuring Sir Paul McCartney, Sia singing in the corner. Nobody could see her face. What was going on with her?
Right.
Yeah, still trying to figure that out.
And I watched it, and that's Sam Smith.
Oh, yes. And yes, yeah, Sam Smith. He killed it last night, you guys.
Yes.
I mean, he was the big winner of the evening. Dominated the awards, winning Best New Artist, Record of the Year, Song of the Year for Stay With Me. And he performed with the fabulous Mary J. Blige.
And so it was really awesome, their performance. Yes.
Yes, yes. So I really enjoyed that. Quick short list of the winners. And shout out to Kendrick Lamar, winning two awards for Best Rap Performance and Song for his latest single, I. Mm-hmm. He was not in the house, and the rumor has it that TDE label mates, they boycotted the Grammys because he was snubbed last year by Macklemore that rap album.
Oh,
but
wow.
that's just a rumor I heard. But
stop.
Yeah, nonetheless, he wasn't in the house, and I found that very sad. But Best R&B Song, Drunk in Love, Beyonce and Jay-Z. Pop album, Tony Bennett and Lady Gaga, Cheek to Cheek. I really enjoyed that performance, by
yes,
the way.
Yes, it was
Lady
good.
Gaga, I loved it.
Say what you want about her persona and her...
She cleaned up real well.
Yes.
Yes, I was very pleased
their
with that.
Their performance was really dynamic.
Yeah, and she just has an amazing voice, so you can't knock her.
Yes.
Shout out to Erica Campbell of Mary Mary for taking home the Best Gospel Album Award for Help.
Mm-hmm.
Pharrell, Happy, Best Music Video. The best movie soundtrack, Frozen.
Hmm.
Did you guys guess that? Because Frozen's been everywhere last year, the Disney film.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Rosie O'Donnell loves her Frozen. She talks about it all the time on The View.
Yes. Pharrell also picked up the Best Urban Contemporary Album Award for Girl. Carrie Underwood for Best Solo Performance, Something in the Water. Band Perry for Best Group. And Album of the Year, Best Rock Album, Beck, Morning Phase. And mm-hmm. so I don't know if you guys caught Kanye.
He was about to do another.
He's gonna try it, y'all. His little sticky fingers. Oh, he wanted to do
his
it so
finger,
bad.
His finger was on that trigger.
I'm so glad that. I'm so glad he declined.
I think he was being sarcastic the way he went
too.
Up and went back down.
I think he was. Too.
He was joking. Yeah.
I
mean, he was joking.
I think so.
Yeah, but that was pretty interesting. But overall, some amazing performances. Great night for music.
I like the
what
fact.
Were your, what were the highlights you guys enjoyed?
I loved listening to Annie Lennox. Voice.
Was she not fabulous?
Annie Lennox, after all these years of being in the Eurythmics, and she actually, Nicki Minaj did one of her, redid one of her songs. Yes. That's Annie Lennox.
That's exactly what you're talking about. But yeah, I mean, yeah.
Yes.
Just an amazing musician. Love her. Love, love, love her. So that was awesome.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was the Grammys last night. And you know what? I am so interested to see what new music we can look for in the summer. And you know, so that was that.
Okay.
And you know, I wanted to move on to something a little bit more serious, especially as we're talking about music. And just kind of sending a prayer out. Basically, for Bobby Christina. You guys have heard about Whitney Houston's daughter. She is in a medically induced coma right now after being found by a family friend in a bathtub on January 31st. It does not look good. Details are sketchy surrounding the event. But what we do know is the family has been told by doctors to prepare for the worst. Unfortunately, taking her off life support is suggested at this point. But we believe in the power of prayer, and
it's
a very unfortunate situation. And authorities have started to focus on her boyfriend, Nick Gordon, because she had some injuries, and they're alluding to abuse and foul play.
Uh-huh.
Kind of prior to her being found.
I hadn't heard about that.
So there's an interesting twist. So either he is a person of interest or a scapegoat. Who knows? I just think it's eerily similar to the death of her mother also being found in a bathtub
right before
the Grammys in 2012.
Yeah.
So, you know, just with all of this stuff surrounding it, you know, Bobby is on record saying, "We continue to request privacy in this matter. Please allow for our family to deal with this matter and give Bobby Christina the love and support she needs at this time." So,
understandable.
At the behest
of
the family.
Go out to the family, Bobby
Absolutely.
Brown, her grandmother, Sissy, and the rest of the family.
Mm-hmm. And also pray for Dionne Warwick. I know she had a fall a couple of weeks
ago,
and that also came out.
Right.
So just a lot going on with the family in general. Just lift them up in prayer, people, because, you know, we don't know what's going on behind the scenes, but we just really need this girl to push through.
Absolutely.
That's right.
Yeah, so I did have something on community news, and this is just really in regards to minority groups backing the energy companies in the fight on solar power. And the best way that I can explain this is, you know, public housing, low-income housing, generally don't have the best amenities. And what they're trying to do is push for this National Black Caucus, the NAACP, the Presente.org, which is a Latino-based organization. And they're really just trying to get the awareness out about how to save energy and really cut the cost for people who can't afford the high energy rates here, especially in Los Angeles. So I'll be putting some more information about that out, but they're working on the grounds trying to get government to start really laxing on some of these additional taxes and stuff that we see coming down the pipe.
Right.
If you ever pay attention to your energy bill, there are a gabillion taxes, y'all.
Yes.
And you'd be like, well, what is
they really are, what particularly
is the,
here.
What is the air fund fee and what is all of this other stuff? So
yeah.
this is something that I thought would be good as far as community news, because I think it's affecting everybody.
Yeah.
So pay attention to your bills.
Taxes is crazy.
And there are some low-income programs, guys, but you just have to do your research. So call your company and
they're
ask.
They're out there.
You have to educate yourself. You know, knowledge is power.
Yes.
That's the wrap for my report, people. So, as always, follow me at Mika the Diva on Twitter and tweet us at Aim to Purpose. Let us know your thoughts and see y'all next time.
And thank you for that report. And just to add quickly, I was the keynote speaker at the Divine Sisterhood event this weekend, and it was really a dynamic event. I had a great time, did a great speaking engagement about rocking God's glory, the greatness within you, and how to let your power loose. So it was awesome, and I give a shout out to Divine Sisterhood.
Yes, and we'll have those. We'll have the video up soon, so everybody can check it out.
We'll have clips from it.
What a wonderful motivational speaker Miss Mama Louise Hicks is.
You hear that, Mama Louise Hicks?
Yes.
I like that.
Yes. And so, once again, thanks guys for your time, and I'll see y'all next Monday.
Next week. Yes. Yes.
Bye. Now we got to get ready for some sports therapy here in the house.
All right.
Well, let's do it this way. Here for sports therapy, let's go to Robert Snell. Robert, what you got for us?
Digging the promo. Thanks for the introduction, Ken. All right. So as Luis mentioned earlier, Valentine's Day is quickly approaching, but Knicks fans are not feeling the love from owner Jim Dolan.
Mm-hmm.
So, over the weekend, a fan who claimed to be a Knicks fan since 1952, he's not feeling the ways of the Knicks are in the way they're currently run. Currently, they have a 10-41 record. That's one of the worst in the NBA.
Whoa.
So the fact that this guy is even admitting he's a Knicks fan right now deserves credit. But he went on in the email to Jim Dolan to basically criticize the team and say what he thinks he could do better. And, closed the email with, I like the way your father ran the team, but I think it's time for you to sell it, you know? And Jim responded by saying, basically, he accused the fan of being an alcoholic. He said, I hope you don't plan on coming to any more Knicks games because we're happy to give you the Nets. And this goes completely everything they teach you in business, that the customer is always right.
Mm-hmm.
But this is not the first time, unfortunately for the NBA, that an owner has gone out and actually hated on the customer. Obviously, the very famous Don T. Sterling case came about last April, where he went after African-American NBA fans who attended Clippers games, specifically Magic Johnson, who took a picture with his then-mistress. I'm not sure what their status is now. And and of course, Donald T. then. And Donald T. was then removed from the league by Commissioner Adam Silver.
Yeah.
And then over summer, a much less publicized but equally hateful message was brought into public light when, over the summer, Atlanta Hawks former owner, Bruce Levinson, had a 2012 email surfaced where he said, and I quote, "My theory is that the black crowd scared away the whites and there are simply not enough affluent black fans to build a significant season ticket base."
Wow.
And
what is this person again? I need to...
He was now former Atlanta Hawks owner Bruce Levinson. He was forced to sell the team actually during the season. And the reason why no one ever heard that story was because ESPN was too wrapped up with the whole Ray Rice
party. Of course.
Because I'm saying Robert. Thank you. I needed therapy, obviously.
But
oh my gosh.
The relevance of those two are, after those comments, both owners were removed, right? And I realized that was race. But this is the same concept of the customer's always right, and any owner should be thrilled when anyone decides to spend their hard-earned money on their product, and especially when you're only a 10-41 product.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, anything.
You should be thanking your people for coming to see your games.
Exactly.
I agree. Goodness. Now, here's the interesting part. So Adam Silver was very harsh in his first two things and essentially forced the two previous owners to sell their team. But he has actually announced that Jim Dolan will not have any repercussions taken against him at the minute. And ever since he has said there will be no actions, you know, no fines, no suspensions against Jim, that's when it gained a lot of media attention. And Deadspin is actually the one that carried the story and released the emails to the public. And now there's a lot of public backlash. Because if you guys don't know, this year's NBA All-Star Game will be held in New York.
It's in New York, yeah.
Exactly, where Jim Dolan's, you know, team, the New York Knicks, play. And now there's question of whether or not Adam Silver is showing favoritism in his decision not to punish Jim because he is hosting the All-Star Game and he doesn't want that black eye to come about and people to potentially boycott.
Boycott the game.
Exactly, because it will be held in his arena.
Yeah.
So then my question to you guys and to my followers, and you can tweet me at rsnellradio.
Yes.
What are your comments? What do you think Adam Silver should do about this? Because I think that this is irrehensible, something that cannot be tolerated by the league, and they need to nip this in the bud because Jim Dolan is an ambassador to the league, whether or not he likes it, and he has to act accordingly. And that was not anything politically correct or just the way you would want to treat a friend or especially a fan of your team.
Well, I think they should have a standard about, you know, just all across the board.
Yeah. At the end of the day, the NBA is a business, and it needs to be run like a business.
It does.
And, you know, I mean, the NBA All-Star Weekend itself makes millions of dollars
so
in
much.
That entire weekend itself.
It's ridiculous.
And they depend on promotional things, and that may be part of the reason why they don't want advertisers to get, you know, fearful of having to distance themselves from the news.
Money's definitely the motivation. Mm-hmm.
I agree, too. But my thing is, I would like to see some sort of action taken against Jim Dolan, because if being a terrible owner and putting a terrible product was enough, then to have the audacity to, you know, basically spit on your fans who still care and support the team despite your losing ways is just irrehensible. So I'd like to see, the fan rewarded for his loyalty. I'd like to see, actually, the league step in and give him something, because it's clear the Knicks won't. And then for, you know, obviously the Knicks owner Jim Dolan to apologize to that fan and be punished accordingly.
So interesting how your sports therapy really kind of plays into what we're talking about today, how words can really change your world.
Yes.
And how we're going to be talking about the five strategies of for getting results. And sometimes you can get the results that you really don't want because you open your mouth and put your foot in it.
Yeah.
Well, we will see how that pans out in the few weeks to come. So thank you, Robert.
Yeah, I'll be sure to update you guys.
Thank you, Robert.
Absolutely.
Yeah, by all means. And thanks.
No problem.
Thank you, Robert and Shamika, for presenting us with the happenings and news and community and sports.
We're the new news source, y'all.
There you go.
Tuning in. Thanks very much.
Yes.
All right.
The new kids on the block.
And with that being said, we're going to take our first break. And we're going to come back with our featured guest, Linda Coleman-Willis.
And we're going to talk about the five strategies for getting amazing results.
Yes.
So we'll be right back.
Hey, folks, it's Ken here. If you or someone you know around the world has a small business, organization, or foundation you'd like to share with the Aim to Purpose audience, showcase it here on our segment of the show called Small Business Monday. The opportunities for people around the world to browse, buy, and use your products and services are endless. We pre-screen all businesses, organizations, and foundations for legitimacy, but because this is a free community service brought to our audience, it's at no cost to you as well. You heard it right. It's absolutely free, and you don't have to pay one penny. How do you like that? You just come on down to the studio and tell the story of your business, organization, or foundation and give it the praises and accolades you know it deserves. If you're in another part of the state or country, or if you're in another part of the world, you can easily call in or Skype in and do the same. So what are you waiting for? Contact the show's publicist, Shamika Brown, at www.divinebrownmedia.com. She can also be contacted at 1-818-533-8463 or contact Louise Hicks at www.louisehicks.biz. She can also be contacted at 1-562-310-1495. Allow yourself to be seen by the global masses and allow your business to shine and grow because of the global masses. It's Small Business Monday, courtesy of Aim to Purpose, the radio show.
Hello, world. Again, I'm Louise Hicks of Aim to Purpose, the radio show. We are back with our dynamic guest today, Miss Linda Coleman-Willis. And we're going to go ahead and tell you a little bit about Linda. Ken, take it away.
Yes, Linda Coleman-Willis is one of America's leading experts in the areas of personal growth and development. She is a certified performance results coach, an award-winning speaker, best-selling author, magazine columnist, TV radio personality, and a highly sought-after speaker and trainer for organizations and corporations across the country. Her powerful messages of overcoming obstacles, learning to go the distance, and getting results have helped to create positive change in the lives of thousands of people and organizations nationwide. Linda is past president of National Speakers Association Los Angeles chapter, listed in Who's Who in Professional Speaking Great Women Speakers, and is winner of National Speakers Association's Golden Microphone Award and the prestigious Connie Award for Platform Excellence. So with that being said, let's welcome in the studio our featured guest, Linda Coleman-Willis.
Hello, Linda, and thank you for joining us today. And we just appreciate you coming in to share and empower our global guests from around the world today. And let's kind of find out a little bit about you. You're this award-winning speaker. You're an author. You wear many hats in your endeavors and everything you're doing. So let's define yourself and tell us about these performance results. And then we're going to get into the five strategies.
Okay. Thank you. First of all, thank you. I am so excited and delighted to be here.
Yes.
And to share with your audience, your international audience.
We're
that
global.
Excites me. You are global.
Yes.
Yeah. So that means I'm global now, right?
Yes, you are. You are right. Global, right along with us.
You're being seen and heard all over the world.
All over the world.
Wow. How exciting. Okay. Heart be still. Okay.
Right.
As a performance coach, what that means actually is I help people get results or outcomes. That's my purpose. That's my goal. When I work with my clients, my goal is to make sure that they get the outcome that they want. And a lot of times they don't know what that outcome is.
Right.
So I have to help them to define that.
Yes.
And then the performance part of it is we actually do the work.
Mm-hmm.
They have to do the work. And so when I talk about performance, I'm not talking about in the entertainment sense.
Yes.
I'm talking about in the action-oriented, taking steps, doing the work.
Life performance.
Kind of a way, life performance.
Yeah.
Whether it's professional or personal.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. You got to know how to have people to understand and know how, because that's really what holds a lot of people back. They don't know how to define who they are. They don't know how to define their purpose, and they just don't know which direction to go to get the results that they want. And that's where Linda comes in, and she's done so much of this all over the nation. She has been transforming lives with her dynamic award-winning results. And I know when we are working with people, we do have challenges to overcome, because one of the challenges is helping the people to get rid of the fear they have to move them forward so that they can live that dream that they want. So how do you help them, Linda? What are some of the challenges that you face with helping people to get the results they want, whether it's in their personal life or business?
I think the number one challenge I find with the clients that I work with most often is that there is no clarity. They actually don't know. They will have their goals, and of course we know from elementary school probably we were taught to set your goals, right?
Mm-hmm.
Work your action plan, and that's important.
Yeah.
We do need to do that. But my number one thing to all of you is know your outcome.
Okay.
And how do we know our outcome? We have to ask ourselves a question. What is it that I want to happen here?
Mm-hmm.
Not what is it I want to do? I want to do this, I want to do that, and people start running around and doing things.
Mm.
But I want you to stop, and I want you to ask yourself, what is my outcome? What is it that I want to happen here. And if you're not getting the results that you want, it's probably because you're not answering that question.
Yeah.
And so outcome is number one. And then number two is to expand your awareness. Expand your awareness. You need acute awareness. You need to be aware whether or not what you're doing is working.
Yeah.
Is it working? Am I getting results, the results I want?
Yeah.
And are there insights?
And if you feel good about what it is that you're doing.
Right. Right.
You know?
But you know, you have people who are excited about achieving their goals.
Yeah.
But they don't know what that looks like on the other side.
Yes.
Right. And that's kind of where coaching comes in, because we help you to see what you can't see
right.
on your own. And it is so important to get help, to ask for help. But if you get that outcome and you have that expanded vision, if you really have that acute sense of, is there a little bit of movement here? Am I moving?
Mm-hmm.
Is something different happening? And you have to have that expanded acute awareness, or you'll say, okay, can't do it. It's not happening.
Right.
Nothing's happening. But
but
you know what? We expand and grow through our insights.
Mm-hmm.
Did something that wasn't there in your own mind show up while you were in the process of looking at your outcome or trying to achieve your outcome?
That's right.
So that's really important to be able to say, I have a new insight. I have a new revelation.
Yeah.
This is something different. I never looked at it that way.
Mm-hmm.
So an expanded awareness is really important, and an acute awareness of what is actually taking place right before you. You may not have reached your goal, but there's some change there. So there's something happening. There's a difference there.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You and the first one here says know your outcome. What's the difference between knowing your goal and knowing your outcome?
I'm so glad you asked that question,
because
a lot of people know their goal. Let me use myself for an example. When I left my nice job and stepped out here as a motivational speaker, my goal was to become the best motivational speaker that the world had ever heard.
That's right.
I had heard so many motivational speakers, I wanted to be one. So I went to work becoming this great motivational speaker, inspiring people, going to these seminars and being the keynote speaker, and people are standing up giving me a standing ovation.
Yes.
I achieved my goal, but I didn't know what my outcome was.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you asked me, Linda, what are you doing as a speaker, as a trainer, as a coach with your writings, everything? I want to create in the listeners today.
Yes.
I want to give them something of value
right.
that they can use immediately to transform their lives or their professions or whatever it is. My outcome is to have your audience learn something.
That's right.
Not me give a great presentation, and that's the difference.
Yeah.
A goal can be really self-centered,
mm-hmm.
but what is the outcome of my giving that presentation?
Yeah.
Is that audience getting what they need to carry out what it is they want to do?
Yeah.
And it's less about me and more about them.
Yeah, it's about what the service is of the goal.
The result.
Right. Mm-hmm. What are you giving as a part of whatever the goal is? How is it going to benefit or affect everyone involved and the people that you're presenting it to? Because when you go to seminars, you're going to a seminar to get something that you can implement right away.
But
let's say that seminar leader's goal is to have 500 people in the seat, and that goal is achieved. He's successful, right?
Yeah. Right.
Right. That's my goal.
Right.
But what about those 500 people
Absolutely.
That were in the seat?
Yeah.
What was the outcome
yeah.
of that
yeah.
that
yeah.
successful
yeah.
seminar?
The speaker
That's
accomplished
the difference.
Their goal.
Right.
But
right.
the 5,000 in the audience possibly
didn't.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
So, and that's
yeah.
why you look at the outcome. If I'm going to put 500 people in this room, what do I want the outcome to be?
Right.
Not my goal is to get 500 people in the seat.
Mm. Right.
My goal may be to make whatever that
Yeah.
translates into money.
Yeah.
But what is the outcome I want to happen here
you want
as
them
a result?
You want them to have the same results that you've
Absolutely.
Achieved.
You should. If you're going
to
be in this
result.
Business for the long haul, you want results. You want your audience. I want the people listening today to say, I never thought of that.
To
That's
get
something
benefits.
That I can benefit. Yeah.
Benefits. Yeah. So that was the key word that you said, Ken, and I'll share this with you. I was the keynote speaker this Saturday at an event, and I saw this lady. She was sitting here and she was texting during the pretty much the whole time I was speaking, she was texting. And after the event was over, she came up to me and she said, "Oh, you may have thought that I was just texting." She said, "But no, I wasn't. I was taking down what you were saying because it was so enlightening to me." And she said, "I needed that." Mm-hmm. And she said, "I was writing notes."
Yeah.
That's what I was doing. So that told me my outcome was good because she was getting some benefits enough where she was writing down what I was saying.
Right.
And that made a difference.
And that doesn't happen accidentally.
No, it
doesn't.
Because
you obviously knew what you wanted your outcome to be.
Yes,
I did.
It was
just about showing up, giving a great keynote
speaker.
We all know in the room, Louise, you can do that.
Yes.
And you would have accomplished your goal. But for someone in your audience to say, I did get a benefit, and this is exactly what I got, and this is what I'm going to do with it, and this is what I can do with it, and it is going to change how I do whatever it is they're doing.
That's right.
Yes.
That's the difference between
that
a
is,
big difference.
That's the big difference. And then another one of the ladies, it was a ladies' conference, another one of the ladies came up to me and said, "Your speaking just affirmed me of what I'm doing and where I want my dream, my goals to go. You just affirm my goals." And on top of that, she's planning some type of conference with 150 ladies. And in that instance, she said, "I want you to be my keynote speaker." And I'm saying, so you know your outcome has been not just to your benefit, but it's been to the benefit of your audience. And that's what you want. It's not about, as you said, Linda, getting people into the room. Because you can have 10,000 people in a room, but if they're not getting the results of what you are imparting, you're not benefiting them.
Mm-hmm. And I think Louise knows that the first question you have to ask yourself when you start planning to talk to that 150 people is, what do I want to happen here? What is the outcome?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because you're going to have 150 people, all different people with different from different walks of life, with different goals, different challenges. And so what is it that I want the outcome to be for the 150 people that's going to be in that room?
Yeah.
And I think that's an excellent place to start.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. It's like the old law of cause and effect. You have the goal, but then you have the outcome, which is the effect, so to speak. You know, everything has its cycle. So
it does.
And one of the things that we're going to talk about is something called cause and effect. It may not come out quite that way because I know a lot of listeners are like, "What?"
Yeah, right.
Okay, but I want you to know that once we know our outcome and once we have our expanded awareness, then we have to look at being flexible in what we do.
Behavior, flexibility.
That's right. Exercise,
that's
behavior, flexibility.
Okay. That's a
the
great
third
tool
one.
To have.
That's
great
the
tool.
Third one. So that requires us to remove all of these preconceived notions we have about whether or not something is working, whether or not it's successful. I have to keep doing it whether it's working or not. No, we need to be flexible in our behavior, in what we do. And there's only, I know people don't like to hear the word change, so I'm saying flexibility.
Okay.
I didn't say that you have to remake yourself.
Right.
But we need to be flexible in our behavior. And there's two ways we change, through procedure. And the second one is perception. Perception is a mental change, really, and procedure is a physical change.
Yeah.
So what we do and how we think, our preconceived ideas can limit us.
Yeah.
So we need to find ways of releasing that preconceived idea of what it is that we can do to be successful.
Yeah,
and a lot of that comes through coaching, of course.
Yeah, because your flexibility. Flexibility is huge. You have to be flexible because if you have a business, you're going to have people that are going to be running your business. You have different personalities that you have to interact with, and you have to be flexible. Your perception of people will kind of, create your how flexible you are, I mm-hmm. guess, mm-hmm. you know, because you have to be with a certain type of people. You have to deal with other people. You have to negotiate with people about certain business ideas and this and that and the other. So you have to, being flexible is, like you said, not change, but being flexible, which means that you can take it in any direction you want.
Mm-hmm. And being aware, that acute awareness as to what's working and what's not working, mm-hmm. and asking yourself, is this working or is it not working?
Right.
Is there something I need to do differently, or right. maybe I need to do more of?
Yeah.
And so when people really understand that they can control and they are in charge of and they are responsible for the yeah. things that's going to happen in their mm-hmm. lives or in their business,
yeah.
that flexibility is the key.
Yeah.
Because all of us set goals. I have goals. I still set goals.
Yeah. Yes.
But I often have to do some kind of changing there at times.
Of course.
Yeah.
Of course.
So you have to ask yourself, is it working?
Yeah.
And I like
Am I getting
that,
the results I want?
And that's so true. And I like what you said about the procedure and the perception. Those two steps, I guess you would call them,
mm-hmm.
procedure and perception. And is that what you would do to effect a lasting change, and when you're doing what you're coaching, because I can see you're a very impactful coach. I can see that coming through right
oh, yeah.
now.
Thank oh, you. Yeah.
Powerful and empowering.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It has to resonate, you know. It has to be something that resonates with those 500 people, mm-hmm. because everyone's not going to get it,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Yeah.
At least not in that one seminar. Mm-hmm. It may take two or three before something actually clicks.
Now, you remember what I said, and I want to reiterate to your audience.
Mm-hmm.
I want to give them something that they can use immediately. They can use immediately. I didn't
okay.
say anything about immediate change
yeah.
because
right.
it may not happen immediately.
That's right.
But you can use, you take these strategies and put them to work.
Right.
And then you look, remember acute awareness, to see if it's making a difference. If there's something, even if that difference is just an insight.
Right.
That says, I can do this differently,
yeah.
and this is the result I get.
It's the self-awareness.
Okay. And
you
helping
know?
Them
it
to
is.
Get clarity.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
what's the next one I like on your, that you, the,
controlling the emotional state. And
yes.
now, you have already said that cause and effect.
Yeah.
That's where the cause and effect comes in pretty much on the next two steps.
Mm-hmm.
But when we talk about controlling emotional states, emotion is a state. I hear people say, when I get the perfect job, I'll be happy, or when I, whatever it is, I'll be happy. No,
yeah.
you can be happy now. That's a state.
That's right.
Yes.
That means that we can induce ourselves. That I can happen, you can be happy right now. Give you an example. If you think of something right now that you were so excited about, that had you, look at you smiling already, get something in your mind that you were
yeah.
happy about, that you were excited about, that you were enthusiastic
yeah.
about.
Yeah.
And watch your physiology and everything will change.
It changes. That's right.
And you're going to be happy.
Yes, it does.
So that means that we have the power to make ourselves happy at any moment.
That's right.
We don't have to wait. When I talk about outcomes, there are steps involved
right.
for an outcome. But for a state, it's immediate.
Mm-hmm.
And you have the power. You have the control.
Yes.
Yeah.
And you deserve it. You just have to believe that. And the
yeah.
other thing I have people do a lot of times in my seminars is, I'm not talking about clinical depression, because we all know that there are people out there that it's a serious problem.
Of course.
And if there is clinical depression,
yeah.
get some professional help.
Right.
I'm talking about the gloomer doomers, the people who just think that they have to have $1 million before they can be
yeah.
happy.
Yeah.
You may never be happy.
That's true.
Okay. So you can be happy right now, today, right now, during this program.
That's
there
right.
is happiness in the room.
Absolutely.
There should be happiness in the audience, because you can do that. But the other thing is, in my seminars, I have people do this. And especially when I see people are kind of down, you know, sometimes it's early in the morning and they're not energetic yet.
Mm-hmm.
And I ask them to think of something that makes them laugh. It
yeah.
can be a joke. It can be something, a movie they saw last night.
Yeah.
It can be anything, as long as it makes you laugh. Can you think of something that makes you laugh?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Makes you laugh out loud, right?
Right.
And then I tell them, look up at the ceiling and be depressed. And you see they're still laughing.
Or you can curl up and be sad all day.
Yes, you can.
You know?
But you can't if you do these exercises, because a positive and a negative thought cannot
yeah.
Occupy the same space.
No,
that's
it's
right.
impossible.
They can't.
No, they
can't occupy the same space. You have the power to be happy. It's your choice.
As
it is.
Where Pharrell Williams say, happy.
Happy.
Yeah.
And I say, learn to control your emotional states. Okay.
Yeah. And all of us, the one thing that we take for granted is the fact that we do have control. Most of us make the excuse of everything outside of themselves. Oh, I didn't get it because of this happened, or I didn't get that because that happened, or that person did this, or he did this to me, or she did this to me. Everyone, all 7 billion of us on this planet, have individual control over how we think, how we perceive, and how we choose to respond to outside influences.
We should have.
And we definitely should have.
Yeah,
we should.
Yeah.
But we don't always do that, and that's what gets us stuck sometimes in despair. And we know we're human, and we go into despair. I mean, all I have, myself, sometimes. But it's when you get stuck there and you stay there. And the words you use that come out of your mouth, the words that you think in your head, they can really do damage to you. And we have a video clip coming up about those things. You want to say something?
Okay. No, I was just going to say that's going to be number 5. You guys are leading right into
that's
step
right.
number 5.
So that's right. Adopt, empower, when you're going to talk about that. And this is number 5. But what we're going to do, we're going to take a commercial break. And then we're going to come back with our video clip and talk about strategy number 5.
Okay.
This edition of Aim to Purpose, the radio show, is brought to you by L. Hicks Consulting Services. When you want the best in business coaching, life coaching, or perhaps your organization, business, or company is in need of a dynamic speaker for an upcoming workshop or seminar, contact Louise Hicks for L. Hicks Consulting Services at 1-562-310-1495. From anywhere around the world, that's 1-562-310-1495. For more information about Louise Hicks and her consulting services, visit her website at www.louisehicks.biz. Again, that's www.louisehicks.biz. Or call 1-562-310-1495. L. Hicks Consulting Services, where professionalism is top priority.
Okay, world, we're back, and thank you all for listening. We're having this dynamic, impactful, empowering conversation with Linda Coleman-Willis, who is just an extraordinary award-winning speaker, author, coach. She has done national work all over the United States, maybe international too, but I know nationally. And we're just having a great talk about the 5 strategies that she used to get amazing results, not just in your personal life, but in your business life. And we've talked about a few of them already, which is know your outcome, expand your awareness, exercise behavior flexibility, and control your emotional state. So now Linda's going to give us the 5th one, and we have a video clip also that we're going to share with you. So go ahead, Linda, and give us the 5th one.
Well, the 5th one, I think, is one of the most important ones, and that is adopting empowering beliefs. And I think we talked about it a little bit, because our belief system controls everything that we do. It controls our emotions, our thoughts. It controls our lives. It controls whether we believe that it's possible or impossible, whether we think we can or we can't.
Yep.
I mean, it is so important that we understand that we have some control. Mm-hmm. It's a little bit more than a state, like emotions, but it is our thought process. Mm-hmm. And so we can learn to think empowering thoughts. Why not? Because disempowering thoughts disempower us.
Very true.
Whether you think you can, you're right. Whether you can't, you're right.
You're right.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
And that is so true. I remember as a kid growing up in Shreveport, my grandmother was very influential in my life because I lived with her a short while after my grandfather passed away, and until I graduated from high school, actually from 4th grade. And she used to always hear saying, oh, I can't do this, can't do that. And my grandmother said, look, take can't out of your vocabulary. She just told us, stop saying that, because you can do anything you want to do within the power that God has given you to do it. So stop it. And I learned as a very young girl to stop saying, I can't do this and I can't do that. Because believing is seeing. If you believe it, you can see it.
And that was a gift from your grandmother, because most of our beliefs are set when we're very young.
Of course, yeah.
And most of us has never done anything to change it. We don't even know it exists. Mm-hmm. It's like a record going off in our brains and in our minds. And if we got it from our parents and our teacher and our friends, we believe it. It became a part of who we are, and we've never examined it.
That's right.
So we need to know that when we're talking to ourselves in our own mind, and if it's negative, and unfortunately the experts say 90% of it is negative, then we know that we need to create some new empowering beliefs. Because I feel this way. It's not my fault. You hear that a lot.
Right.
But is it your responsibility?
Yeah.
That's what you have to ask yourself.
Yeah.
Because
that's a good one. Yeah. We have to be responsible.
Oh, yeah. Everybody's responsible for their own thoughts, their own actions, their own successes and their own failures.
And your own words. And speaking
and
of words, let's go ahead and share this video clip because it is very impactful and empowering about the words you speak and the words that you write down as well.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
Now, we're going to ask Linda to just explain that to us. Linda, the dynamic coach, phenomenal woman we have here.
Wow.
I like that clip.
First, let me applaud her.
Yes, I like that
because
clip.
Because we pass by people. I mean, most people probably didn't even see him. You know, they're in their own world, and neither did they see that beautiful day, unfortunately.
Right.
But the fact that there was a sign that said, I'm blind. It's a beautiful day and I can't see it.
Mm-hmm.
I think it touched them in two ways. Number one, they could see it.
They could.
And they
That's
were
right.
not seeing it.
That's right.
You know, and so that was a reminder. And the second thing is to think that he had the wisdom. And I know someone else wrote it. But for them looking at the sign to say, he's right.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a
he
beautiful
can appreciate
day.
This day,
and
he can't
see
even
it.
See it.
Yeah. Yes.
So I think that those words are like, okay, are you walking through life and not seeing it, not enjoying it, not understanding the power that we have to make it a beautiful day, even if the rain, even if it's raining.
Yeah.
The sun can shine in the midst of rain,
yes,
in the midst
can.
Of pain.
It's a wonderful day.
Yes.
Regardless.
Because it's those thoughts that we have.
Well, it's about perception. Everything is perception, how we see. You can have that same person sitting on the curb like that, and 10 people will perceive it in 10 different ways.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you see the same thing, but you perceive it in 10 different ways. The power of belief and words. I read a wonderful book called Hung by the Tongue. What you say is what you get. It's from more biblical passages from the Bible, but nonetheless, the words and the ideology that words have a vibration to them, and the words words that you say really don't mean anything. It's the intention behind the words that that make them powerful, and how you perceive those words. So words words do hold weight.
Yes, they do. As you can see, his sign said something to the effect, "Please, I'm blind, please help." And this lady comes along, and he was getting a little money, but not much. And then she changed the sign to say, "It's a beautiful day, but I can't see it." How powerful is that to motivate people? Because it gives them a thought process then. As you said earlier, Linda, procedure and perception. So it changed their perception, and she changed the procedure of how what he had written.
Yep.
So words are so powerful, and it just goes along with those strategies that you talked about, and how we know, lots of people know what to do, but few of us know what we know. We think we know something, and we might not know it. So explain how that works. How do we get people to do the work and to get the results and the outcome they want?
I think it's people really know what to do. Most of us know what to do, but it's doing.
Yeah.
It's the doing. It's doing what we know. That is the challenge. And I think the number one is to find someone who's doing it and you know, let them be a role model for you.
Yeah.
Find a coach who can see in you what you can't see in yourself.
That's right.
Who can help you look at those areas of your business, your profession, your life that may be blind to you. You may have a blind spot. And not only that, if you know what to do, again, look at what outcome you want. What is the outcome you want? Maybe you are setting your goals, and maybe you are making a plan, and maybe you are working your plan, but you don't know where you're going.
Right.
You don't know what it is that you want. You don't know what it looks like when you get there.
Yeah.
And I think that is a challenge for a lot of people. And then this idea of empowering beliefs. I want to go back to that for a moment.
Oh, absolutely.
Because one of the things that I think happens with people a lot is that they give definition to certain things. And one of the words I want to talk about, and I think you brought it up earlier, and that word is failure.
Yeah.
What does failure mean? It's over.
Yep.
I'm out of the game.
Yep.
I'm a loser. Oh, no, it's... No. What if your empowering belief said to you, it's a major life lesson that I needed to learn, and I'll move on from here.
Yep. Yes.
Did you fail? No.
No.
I make failure impossible because I learned something of value that I can use to move my business or my life or whatever forward.
Yeah.
That's not failure.
No, it's
not. So I just changed the whole definition of failure.
That's
I cannot fail.
That's right.
Now, I have learned some life lessons. I'm going to tell you that.
Right.
And that's what they are. That's what it is.
And it would have been a failure had you given up.
Thank you.
Yes.
It would have been a failure if I accepted your definition or your definition or some other folks' definition of, well, she must be crazy. She's, you know, she's failing. She has failed. Why is she still doing this? So why? And because in my mind, I haven't failed. As a matter of fact, I no longer see failure.
Yeah.
But I do see life lessons. I do see something tapping me on the shoulder to remind me that maybe I need to do it a little differently, or maybe I need to get some help.
Yeah.
Maybe I need to find a coach, or maybe I need to be a coach. I don't know what it is.
Or find a mentor.
Or a role model.
Yes.
And life itself is an experience or journey of experiences. And it all goes into how you perceive your experience. If you perceive it as your error as a failure, then that's exactly what it will be. Like you said, whether you can or you can't, either way you're right.
Either way you're right. and I had a client once who said, okay, this is it.
Yeah.
If it doesn't work this time, this is it.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, what's so it about it?
It's never it.
It's never it. But to him, this is it.
Yeah.
If it doesn't work this time.
Yeah.
And I'm saying, well, okay, tell me what the it is all about.
Right.
Well, I've failed so many times, and my friends are saying I should stop, and my family is saying this, and I'm like, but what are you saying?
Yeah.
What is it that? Yeah. What is it that you're saying?
Right.
Let's move it.
Yeah.
There's no final it
until
you're not here anymore.
Because there are limitless possibilities. And you're right. And some people even say, oh, I'm too old. They need to take that out too. And I like this how you said that people know. How do you put it? They know what to do.
We know what to do.
We know what to do.
We have to do what
we
know.
But we need to do what we know.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's it. I kind of worded it wrong. But.
And you also say knowing is not enough.
It's the doing.
It's the action.
The doing. That's right.
Of
action.
The knowing.
Right.
Because I have those elements of aim to purpose, which are vision, hope, faith, knowledge, and action. And when you know what to do, but if you don't do it, you don't get to work.
Yeah.
You're not going to get any results.
Yeah.
But we do want to emphasize, because a lot of people will say, well, I am tired. I'm beat up. You don't have to do it alone. And that's the other message we need to send.
Yeah.
You don't have to do it alone.
That's right.
I have had coaches. I won't say my entire career, but I wished I had my entire career. I have had help. It was very difficult for me, because I remember my first coach I had, and I would say to her, why should I pay someone to do that? I can do it. And she said, Linda, because you can doesn't mean you should.
Mm-hmm.
That is true.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, what's your outcome? What is it? What are you working toward?
Yeah.
Does that lead you there?
That's
that may
right.
get you know, some files filed or whatever, but that's not what you should be doing.
Yeah. Everyone has to know that they can't do everything.
They can't do everything.
You know?
No, you can't. And that's why we are all put here with different gifts and talents, and we need to wrap it up. We're getting close to time out, but Linda has given us some excellent strategies. Know your outcome. Expand your awareness. Exercise behavior flexibility. Control your emotional state. And the most significant one, she said, is adopt empowering beliefs.
Yeah.
And with that being said, Linda, briefly tell us, what are some of the advantages of working with a coach like yourself? And we need to kind of, we have a couple of minutes, you can share that with us.
I think one of the biggest advantages is that a coach is an accountability partner.
Yeah.
They hold you accountable for what you say you want.
That's right.
And the other thing is that they can ask you these questions, and they can lead you and direct you in areas that you can't do for yourself. A coach is someone who can help you to see, I say sometimes, see in the darkness, in the dark spots, in the dark spaces, can see where your weaknesses are, where your strengths
are.
That's right. A lot of people don't know what their strengths are. They don't know what their weaknesses are.
Yeah.
The coach that I'm working with right now, we're in the process of rebranding me. And so that requires, Linda, you've done all these things. You heard all the things that I've done. I've done them.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So how do we package all of that?
Yeah.
How do we brand all of that so that will be who I am?
Yeah.
And what? How can I be even more beneficial to the people that I work with? And so we all need help. Michael Jordan had a coach his entire career.
Yes.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's
so we all need help.
Yeah.
But it does. Someone said, I don't ask for help because I'm weak. Mm-hmm. I ask to remain strong.
There you go.
That's great.
A coach gives you that strength
that
you need to say, you need someone to say sometimes it's okay. There's no such thing as failure. This is not it.
Yeah.
This is not that final. Nothing is that final.
It's
not
it.
You need another voice sometime to get inside that self-talk that you're
having.
And really quick, being that a personal fitness trainer and nutrition and wellness counselor, when I talk to people, it's coaching.
Mm-hmm.
For people that don't have the knowledge that I may have. And I can give that to them so they can implement it.
Mm-hmm.
And they have to have a certain commitment and wherewithal
you're going to hold
that.
Them accountable.
That's right. Hold them accountable.
Said, you're going to hold them accountable. They are there to lead, and they are there to bring you out of those dark spots, as you say, and redirect and help you to brand yourself. And so with that being said, we need to wrap it up. Linda, just give us a final thought and tell them, the audience, how to get in touch with you.
Yes.
Linda Speak at AOL.com is my email, and my website is lindaspeak.com. Everything is Linda Speak.
Linda Speak.
Or Linda Speaks with an S on the end. You can't get it wrong.
Okay.
LINDASPEAKS. Linda.com.
LindaSpeak.com. Is the website without the S on the end.
Oh,
it's the
okay.
Website. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
LindaSpeak without the S.
On the end.
On the end. Mm-hmm. LindaSpeak.com.
And if you want to email her, it's LindaSpeak@AOL.com, mm-hmm. correct?
Yes, LindaSpeak@AOL.com. Mm-hmm. And with that being said, we need to wrap it up.
Yes, we want to thank you, Linda, for being our guest on the show. You are, I like your passion in your voice, which means that you, this is in your heart and this is what you believe in and you want to give it to the world.
I do.
Which is why you're here.
And
so we want to thank you for
giving it to the world.
I'm giving it to the world. Yes. And you know what? I'm getting it back.
There you go.
And
that's the beauty.
That is the beauty of it.
We talked about that earlier.
Yes, mm-hmm. we did. You mm-hmm. give and you
and
get,
you
it,
get
back.
It back.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And with that being said, we'd like to wish everybody a happy Valentine's Day. I have my red on, as I said, and we will see you all next Monday where we will talk real purpose and real talk and keep you aimed to your purpose. And with that being said, always remember, your power lies within you. Let it loose. Until next week.
Yes.